We are committed to bringing community access to learn about African-centered culture heritage and its place in the global community. Pyramid's unique vision, and that's what we offer, a unique vision, is to encourage all students, educators, and the community at large to read and enjoy the reading process. The books that we have chosen to examine are unique technique and books that explore the magnificence of the African diaspora and how the diaspora relates to each person's life. Our website is located at the bottom. So all the materials that we will be presenting and all the resources, you can find them at the website. And we have a link attached where you can go and get all those materials. Feel free to visit us too for author events, book signings, African-centered study groups, and so forth. And all that you can find on our website. Thank you, and enjoy the presentation. This presentation is titled "The African Diaspora Dissected Through Literature, Literature in the Diaspora." And the desired outcomes is we look to enhance your knowledge of literature in the African diaspora. We also looking for one of the desired outcomes is to examine, we're going to examine literary devices used by authors in the African diaspora. And another outcome is to the amplification of culture context and cultural factors. And one of the most important desired outcomes of this presentation is to highlight double consciousness in literature. Double consciousness in literature in the oppressed, colonized, and people that were enslaved in the entire African diaspora. And so pay attention for that and look out for that, because that's what we're designing to do. This presentation was inspired by Dr. Frances Cress Welsing. She's an ancestor now. And this book, Isis Paper, was desired. It sparked this presentation. And I'm going to read a little bit about the subtitle of this book, which I thought was fascinating. And it will give an idea of where we're going in this presentation. And she says, in part, the subtitle of this work, The Keys to the Color, and that's the subtitle of her book, came from a statement made to me by a patient in Washington, D.C. public mental health clinic in the late 1960s. The patient was a tall, thin, middle-aged, black-skinned man in a somewhat confused manner, talked earnestly to me about the problem he had experienced in his life. He said, "Doctor, if I could just find the keys to the colors." And he repeated it again slowly. "Doctor, if I could just find the keys to the colors." It was a statement I never have been able to forget, she says. This work is a portion of my response. And this presentation will be a portion of our response to the keys of the color and how we were able to dissect some of the information. And in part of dissecting, we want to deal with a lot of symbolism. Symbolism in words, and we'll start out with pictures, and then we'll move into symbolism in words. Okay, and she says, she goes on to say, in the form of visual entities, patterns of speech, and or activity, symbols contain complex messages distilled from the conscious level of the brain computer. These messages have been reduced to their essence in the subconscious functioning. There, these highly coded messages are stored and continuously referred to for existence and survival. Once a symbol evolves in a person's subconscious, that person uses the symbol with a high frequency and has little or no necessary conscious understanding of its meaning. A shared symbol speaks volume, although contained in a relatively small visual or auditory package, a symbol speaks loudly or even shouts its meaning without uttering a sound. And we're going to talk about symbols in literature. And before that, we're going to go to a piece of work that inspired her in her book. And we can just move this down a little bit, get me out of the way here. So this is a painting she's using to set the tempo of the book. And we're going to use this to set the tempo of our presentation. And this painting is something that we're asking you to, I don't know, get a take on it and tell us what you see in it. Because, you know, art is suggestive. And, you know, you may like it, you may not like it, but just take a moment to look and see how does this speak to you and what does it say to you? And remember that she said about the symbolism going to the subconscious mind. By the way, this piece was commissioned by the National Museum of Art in Washington, D.C., and it's titled Reconciliation Elegy. An elegy is a play on words with eulogy. So it may tell you something about the painting. And some people say when they see it, I heard some say they see birds on a clothesline. Some even say they see elephants. And I heard someone really dig deeply and say they see phallus symbols. And this worked. And I'll tell you a little bit more about the painting. It's a continuation of the artist Robert Motherwell. And it's a continuation of his early paintings entitled Elegy to the Spanish Republic. And elegy and eulogy is a play on words with each other. So it should tell you a lot about the painting. Okay. So what the painting is and how it speaks to the subconscious mind is, and if you think eulogy to the Spanish Republic, it speaks to what happens when the Moors dominated Spain. So a picture is worth a thousand words, at least to the subconscious mind. It says that what happens when you put too much black on white, the white disappears. And so that was sort of the death of the Spanish Republic. Pretty impressive, I might think. And it really inspired me in order to go deeper into how does this play in the historical evolution of literature from African and the diaspora. Okay, next slide. Let's get our next slide here. Okay. All right. In the beginning was the Word. So when literature first started from the people of the African diaspora for sub-Saharan Africa, and we're going to deal with sub-Saharan Africa. And it's not to say that there was not literature being taught above that in Egypt, but, you know, the Medinetta and Kemetic language. We're going to stick traditionally with the literature, how it evolved in sub-Saharan Africa. And it basically started with griots. And it started with the word. And in griot, it was also what was happening was you had Anansi the spider going on. And it was Uncle Remus over in America and Aesop fables. But traditionally, it was the spoken word. And I'll tell you how powerful that was. Because the spoken word, as it was done by the griots, it consisted of, let's just move this over out of the way here. It consisted of storytelling. And so the storytelling was, it was intense messages to teach about culture and history. And that was so powerful at the time that you'll see it unfolding in today's books by authors of African descent in the entire diaspora, which I found to be really fascinating. Okay. So this is by far one of the most important pieces of literature in American history. And that's Tales of Uncle Remus. So Uncle Remus is the cornerstone, as we came to believe, a big cornerstone of American history and American literature today. And Uncle Remus tales are an African American trickster stories about exploits of Bear Rabbit, Bear Fox, and other creatures that recreated in Black regional dialect by Joel Harris. So Joel Harris observed stories that were told on plantation, and he centralized a character by the name of Uncle Remus, which was a collection of stories that he put together and made them Uncle Remus tales. And that came down the vein of Aesop's fable, and that Uncle Remus was said to be a play on words of Remus and Romulus. And so you can see the symbolism in the words itself, because all the words, like the art we've seen before, evolves from something. And also, while that was taking place in one part of the country, in another part of the country, William Faulkner was following the same line with his words of the animals could talk. And these stories have been translated into nearly 30 foreign languages, and they have an impressive wide influence on writers and popular culture globally. And I would like to say here that I find it fascinating. I was really impressed and taken back when Mark Twain, the premier American author, you know Mark Twain, the writers of Huckleberry Finn, Tom Sawyer, he said that what inspired him more than anything to start his writing career was the tales of Uncle Remus and the adventures of Bear Rabbit. This is what inspired not only Mark Twain, but Charles Chestnut, Zora Neale Hurston, Flannery O'Connor, William Faulkner, Ralph Ellison, and Toni Morrison, along with, of course, Julius Lester, who retold this children's book to take away some of the stigma away from it. But I myself, along with Alice Walker, we're arguing that in effect, it was actually wealth that was stolen from a major part of the Black folks' legacy and authentic African American creators. And no credit on the national stage was ever given to these African American writers and creators. If anything, they seem to have marginalized into a place of not being savvy when it came to coming to literature to the day. And these writings were so profound that they went on to create the characters Peter Rabbit, Winnie the Pooh, Bugs Bunny, the Roadrunner, and it all was influenced by Harrison's creation of Sweet Smart and recognized the human, the animal characters. This is when animals started to talk in children's literature, and it was inspired by The Adventures of Bear Rabbit. This was the fuel that created Warner Brothers, Walt Disney's, and so forth. And a lot of Americans today does not know that it owe a great deal of debt to of literature to the early African American storytellers. Great amount of wealth. And I would like to go on to say we also have at the bottom corner the Coretta Scott King Award. And the purpose of this award is that although we, as people of the African diaspora, created a vast amount of wealth to this literature, there was no recognition. No one ever got recognized, especially with children's books, from the American Library Association until 1969. No person of color had won either the Newbery or the Caldecott medals, and those were distinguished medals in children's literature until 1969, when a group of African Americans got together and created their own literature prize, and it was the Coretta Scott King Award. So as far as the Library Association, no African American person of color ever won an award until 1969, when a group of African librarians decided to get together to create the Coretta Scott King Award. And this is what this award looks like. And a lot of the books that we promote are Coretta Scott King Award winners, along with Newbery and Caldecott. And we're just emphasizing how we have been seem to erase from the importance of literature history in American society. And this award, our own Dr. Henrietta Smith from Palm Beach County edited 4 volumes published by the American Library Association to provide a history of that award. And as you can see, you have a picture of Bear Rabbit. And by the way, Bear Rabbit is a play on words for Brer Rabbit or Brother Rabbit. And so you can see the picture of Bear Rabbit in a confrontation with the character that's sitting on the stump here. And that character, let me just move my face out of the way. That character is called Tar Baby. And so Tar Baby, as the story goes, was created by a fox. And that fox is important component in American literature, because that fox is what inspired the books of the writers of Mark Twain, Huckleberry Finn, and so forth. The author of the books was inspired by the fox in the Bear Rabbit story, and we'll unfold that later. But Bear Rabbit morphed and developed over the period of time and became what we know today as Bugs Bunny. And let's see if you can, and the pictures can tell you of who Daffy Duck was morphed after. And Daffy Duck is always a nemesis of Bugs Bunny. And Daffy Duck morphed out of, or evolved out of, Bear Rabbit nemesis, and that was Tar Baby. And you can see the similarities in the looks and also the personality. I thought that was quite fascinating. Another nemesis of Bugs Bunny, along with Daffy Duck, was Elmer Fudd. And Elmer Fudd, as you can see in the early depictions, Elmer Fudd was also a nemesis of Bugs Bunny. And you can see the early looks of Bugs Bunny and the early looks of Elmer Fudd. And Elmer Fudd was known in the earlier days with the derby. And later on, he morphed into always carrying a gun and chasing after Bugs Bunny. And Elmer Fudd was a fascinating character. Elmer Fudd was morphed after a very early Western writer that wrote about guns. And he was born in 1899. His name was Elmer Keith. Some said, and Elmer Keith, by the way, was famous for inventing the 44 Magnum. And he was known for his cigars and Stetson hat and outspoken opinions. And I'll tell you something that was interesting about him and how that character developed. If, and we're dissecting, remember, so we have to go deeper into our thoughts. And it's not really that far-fetched to pull it together, but he was married to, his wife was Lorraine Randall. And she was known in the 1900s to be a proud member of the Daughters of the American Revolution. So you can see how the character Elmer Fudd had became a play on the person because of the animosity. And I'll tell you something fascinating about Elmer Keith. He was famous for at the time of going to Africa doing hunting. So you can see the culture play out between Bugs Bunny and Elmer Fudd and Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck. It's a cultural play out. And that is part of American culture that has been part of the literary fabric from the beginning of time. I thought it was fascinating. And let's go a little bit deeper. One of the highest grossing sports movie in American history is a movie called Space Jam. Very, very popular movie and grossed in the billions of dollars. The movie is actually about, and if you understand the words and you're able to dissect it, because words are actual symbols. And this picture was a cover picture for the movie. And you notice you have Bugs Bunny, who we came to see as morphed from Bear Rabbit, in between Michael Jordan and this, I guess you say, alien-looking figure. Well, as the story goes, the aliens came to the planet. And I know you all, if any of you all remember Space Jam, this is the story. Aliens came to planet because they needed more entertainment. So what these aliens did, they challenged Bugs Bunny to a basketball game. And the winner, if the aliens won, they were able to take these players back to another planet. And Bugs Bunny agreed to have a basketball game with him, and he brought Michael Jordan on his team. But what the aliens did, Well, they went to a basketball game, and this is in the movie. This is a storyline in the movie. And this talks about Black culture. This is our unique perspective. This talks about Black culture. And this is why this saying we're going to go into double consciousness evolved out of Du Bois, and we're going to put a broader perspective on it. What the aliens did was they came to town, and it's the storyline of the movie, and they stole the talents of NBA players. And when they stole the talents of the NBA players, the aliens became these giant monsters and pretty much dominated the basketball court in the game. And so the basketball players, I think Patrick Ewing was one of them, none of the players wanted to be around them because something hit them and they lost their talents, and they were afraid that that was going to affect the other players. Kind of speaks to a little bit to the COVID-19 that's going on today. But the aliens stole the talents of these NBA players. And as the game went on, they brought in the superstar Michael Jordan to win them back. And as it went, if you know the story, Michael Jordan at the time had retired from basketball and pretty much playing baseball. But this movie sparked him to go back to basketball to become to Michael Jordan as we know today. But notice Bugs Bunny is standing in between the two forces. And as all those, Bugs Bunny was accepted by the larger community, and he became the buffer with the aliens from outer space. Now, some would say, well, this is far-fetched. This is literature. Literature is symbolism. Wile E. Coyote. The coyote and the fox, remember, from Bear Rabbit? Was inspiration to, let's see here. It was inspirational for Mark Twain. Because Mark Twain, the coyote in each episode is insidious and constantly hungry. He had repeated attempts to try to subsequently eat the Roadrunner, but it's never successful. And we all rooted inside of our mind, one day we wanted the coyote to catch Roadrunner. But it was never spoken, but we always thought that. The coyote uses absurdly complex contraption to try to catch his prey, which is comically backfired. And the coyote often, he was getting injured in a slapstick fashion. Many of the items for these contrivances were mail order from a variety of companies, and they were all named Acme. Remember, they were named Acme? And the character was created by Chuck Jones in 1948 for Warner Brothers. And Jones based the coyote on Mark Twain's 1980 book called Roughing It. Mark Twain wrote a book that was published in 1982. And it was called Roughing It, in which Mark Twain describes the coyote as a long, slim, sleek, and sorry-looking skeleton that is a living, breathing allegory of want, and he's always hungry. The coyote is named after, the coyote is actually named Wile E, and it's a pun on words. The E stands for Elderbert, but some say it was a pun for the name of Don Quixote, which was a famous author. And Mark Twain inspired, writing inspired the character that you see in Wile E. Coyote, always chasing the rabbit. And as you can see, it was never the ideas of the griots or the storytellers when they were telling the story for these animals to have this type of personality. But this is the ideas that have morphed into another culture that created so much wealth that has never been credited to the origins of it. Fascinating. Double Consciousness and the Souls of Black Folks by W.E. Du Bois. Okay, what is double consciousness? Double consciousness describes the feeling that you have more than one social identity, which makes it difficult to develop a sense of self. It is a concept that W.E. Du Bois first introduced in his book, The Souls of Black Folks, which was written in 1903. Du Bois believed that African Americans, lived in a society that was oppressive and devalued them as equals. At the same time, African American culture encouraged equality and dignity. This type of double consciousness forced the race to view themselves from the perspective of both cultures, making it difficult for them to unify their African American subculture with their overall African identity. Du Bois believed that this was damage to one's own identity, self-esteem, form because of the negative perceptions and treatments that they received. The internalization of such an anti-Black sentiment from outside their subculture begins to shape their life experience due to the stereotypes perpetrated by the American culture. According to Du Bois, these prejudices encourage doubt, being self-critical, and being indebted. And the introduction to this book goes on to say, and I think the introduction speaks a lot about the book, The Souls of Black Folks, W. Du Bois write about the struggle of the African Americans that have been there since the time of slavery and continues to endure even after emancipation. I'll try to say that three times. He believes that one question that most of the whites want to ask Black people is how does it feel to be a problem? This, although, is never asked directly, but is stated in their actions and made known by what they're saying and doing. Du Bois was made to realize, and this is where this subconscious concept come from, Du Bois was made to realize that he was a problem when he was studying in elementary school in Massachusetts. Remember that, elementary school. As a part of their class project, they were supposed to exchange visiting cards. A girl who was newly admitted to the school refused to give him one. And that is when he understood the difference of his being. As a result of this incident, he decided to educate himself far more than any of his white mates and prove that his existence mattered. Let's ponder that for a moment. As a result of not being accepted, what he did was he doubled his efforts in education. He created a second consciousness. Now, this is an important point to remember as we go through the books, because we're going to see how that unfolded. So you would say, well, Du Bois became one of the best intellectuals in American history. What's wrong with that? Well, it was a response to unfair playing field where he decided that the way was to educate himself. Du Bois went on to become one of the great intellectuals that we know today. But let's look at this. What if Du Bois were here to be something else? That's a point to ponder, because even though Du Bois became one of the great intellectuals, it was a reactionary response to oppression. And he speaks of that double consciousness in the books. And what we're about to discover as we dissect this through literature, that not only does this double consciousness reside in African Americans, but it resides in any society that have been colonized and oppressed. And we can see it unfold in literature. And some of the literature that we're going to investigate are, they have reached the top of the echelon in awards as far as Nobel Prizes and what have you, by wrestling with that double consciousness within themselves. Okay. I had an opportunity at one time to, I had an opportunity to do a book signing with the Nobel Prize laureate. And I was all excited about it because I had never met a Nobel Prize laureate before. And I met Derek Walcott, won the Nobel Prize in Literature. And Derek Walcott is from the Caribbean, and I have a tab down to the bottom of the screen. If you click on that, you can also read the poem as we discuss it. But this poem I thought was fascinating, and it speaks to the double consciousness, and it speaks to Kress, Francis Kress, talking about symbolism. And this is where it shows up in literature, the same double consciousness from a guy from the Caribbean. And it was in his poem. The poem is entitled A Far Cry from Africa. And by the way, when I had this book signing with Derek Walcott, this story is fascinating. We had someone to introduce Derek Walcott, and it was a professor from, I think, of University of Miami, and she put together nice dub poetry to welcome, you know, I guess to with that Caribbean flavor to make him feel comfortable. But as she presented, introduced Derek Walcott, she read her poem, which was in Patois, you know, dub poetry. She read a Patois, and it was like, you know, and she said, the next voice you hear is Derek Walcott. So after she did a poem in Patois, Derek Walcott walks up, this Nobel Prize winner. He walks up and he's getting ready to do his presentation. Everybody's waiting. I'm waiting. And he says, let's just take a break. Let's take 10 minutes and we come back. And Derek Walcott walks off the stage and everybody was dumbfounded. We really didn't know what was going on. And Derek Walcott came back and started talking about his works. And I started to understand about the intensity that he puts in his writing. And this poem, A Far Cry from Africa, we're going to use it to talk about the dissecting of that double consciousness in literature. Remember, Du Bois said it was African Americans. And with our unique perspective, we discovered that it was with all people in the diaspora of the African descent that was either one, oppressed, two, colonized, in addition to the ones that were enslaved. keep those points in mind, because as we go on, we're going to talk about some more literature, and it's important to know those points. And at the bottom of the screen is a little tab that you can click on, and it will take you to the site where you actually can see the poem, A Far Cry from Africa. And we're going to read a little bit of it. And if you can read along, it'll be good. But if you just click on the little pyramid logo at the bottom, the poem will come up, and it's the poem that's in red. And I'm going to read a little bit of it, and just so you can get a feel of the word combination and the literary techniques that he's using. He's using a scattered form of rhyming. Here we go. A wind is ruffling the tawny pelt of Africa. Kikuyu quick as flies, batting upon the bloodstreams of the veldt. Corpses are scattered through paradise. Only the worm, kernel of carrion, cries. Waste no compassion on these death separate dead. Statistics justify and scholars seize the salience of colonial policy. What is that to the white child hiked in bed, to savages expendable as Jews? Thrust out by beaters, the long rushes break. In the white dust of ibis whose cries have wheels since civilization's dawn, from the parched river of beast-teeming plain, a violence of beast on beast is read as a natural law, but upright man seeks his divinity by inflicting pain. Delirious as those worried beasts, his war dance to the tightened cockers of a drum, while he calls courage still that native dread of the white peace contracted by the dead. Again, brutish necessities wipes his hand upon a napkin of a dirty cause. Again, a waste of compassion, as with Spain, the gorilla wrestles with the Superman. I, who am poised with the blood of both, where shall I turn? Divided to the vein, I who have cursed the drunken officer of Britain ruled, how choose between this Africa and the English tongue I love? Betray them both or give back what they give? How can I face such slaughter and be cool? How can I turn from Africa and live? And in this poem, he's talking about that double consciousness. On one hand, he earned a living by his British education of his writing. And on the other hand, his African heritage, he sees the slaughters that is taking place under the continent. So he's wrestling with this idea that Du Bois spoke about, with double consciousness, and you hear it coming from a Nobel Prize winner from the Caribbean. I thought it was fascinating. And let's hear the poem being read.
A wind is ruffling the tawny pelt of Africa. Kikuyu, quick as flies, batten upon the bloodstreams of the veldt. Corpses are scattered through a paradise. Only the worm, kernel of carrion, cries, waste no compassion on these separate dead. Statistics justify and scholars seize the salience of colonial policy. What is that to the white child hacked in bed, to savages expendable as Jews? Threshed out by beetles, the long rushes break in a white dust of ibises whose cries have wheeled since civilization's dawn from the parched river or beast-teeming plain. The violence of beast on beast is read as natural law, but upright man seeks his divinity by inflicting pain. Delirious as these worried beasts, his walls dance to the tightened carcass of a drum, while he calls courage still that native dread of the white peace contracted by the dead. Again, brutish necessity wipes its hands upon the napkin of a dirty cause. Again, a waste of our compassion, as with Spain, the gorilla wrestles with the Superman. I, who am poisoned with the blood of both, where shall I turn, divided to the vein? I, who have cursed the drunken officer of British rule, how choose between this Africa and the English tongue I love? Betray them both or give back what they give? How can I face such slaughter and be cool? How can I turn from Africa and live?
Radical intersection dissecting hip hop and literature. We also was able to unfold that same vein of double consciousness in hip hop. And this one was a rapper by the name of Kendrick Lamar. And the title of this piece was "The Black of the Berry." And this was one of the songs that was on the James Baldwin movie, "I'm Not Your Negro." But Kendrick Lamar, he's an American rapper and songwriter and a record producer. He is regarded by many critics and contemporaries as one of the most influential hip hop artists of his generation, and often cited as one of the greatest rappers of all time. He has amassed a large online following and collaborated with several prominent artists, including The Game, Busta Rhymes, Snoop Dogg. He released his fourth album, Damn, in 2017 to further acclaim. Its single was Humble, and it's topped the U.S. Billboard's Hot 100 chart. While the album became the first non-classical and non-jazz album to be awarded the Pulitzer Prize Award, you got a Pulitzer Prize for music, Lamar has received many accolades over the course of his career. He got 13 Grammys, 2 American Music Awards, 5 Billboard Music Awards, 11 MTV Video Music Awards, a Pulitzer Prize and American Award nomination in 2012. MTV named him the hottest MC in the game on their annual list. And this song, by the way, Obama said in an interview that one of his favorite songs of 2015 was "How Much a Dollar Cost" by Kendrick Lamar. So President Obama was really influenced by him, that he named one of his songs was the best song he heard in 2015. But this song that we're highlighting is "The Black of the Berry, Sweet Juice." We want you to see how the double consciousness is in hip hop. And be advised that this is, we got a parental advisory on it because of some of the lyrics. But how he masterfully woven words together to speak about that double consciousness in itself. And when this song came out, The Black of the Berry, people thought they were saying he was being hard about the killing of Trayvon Martin at the time. And what he was saying, he was talking about the hypocrite within himself, about on one hand, he's promoting gang banging, and on the other hand, he's upset about the shooting of Trayvon Martin. He used the term hypocrite. So double consciousness, as we unpackage it, we would use terms like phony, two-faced it. He uses hypocrite. And in this song, he articulates it real well.
Build and destroy. Remind me of these Compton Crip gangs that live next door. Beef beefing with Pyrus, only death settled the score. So no matter how much I say I like to preach with the Panthers, or tell Georgia State Marcus Garvey got all the answers, or try to celebrate February like it's my B-Day, or eat watermelon chicken and Kool-Aid on weekdays, or jump high enough to get Michael Jordan endorsements, or watch BET cause urban support is important. So why did I weep when Trayvon Martin was in the street, when gangbanging make me kill a nigga blacker than me? Hypocrite.
So remember we said that double consciousness was oppression, enslave, or colonized. So one of the professors at the last institute mentioned to me, he says, what about Ethiopia? It's never been colonized. It has never been enslaved. So how do you speak with double consciousness from Ethiopia? Well, that was a challenging question, and it forced me to get one of the best writers of the time out of Ethiopia, had to read the book, the new Magestu, I hope I'm not butchering his name, but his book is The Beautiful Things That Heaven Waits. And the book starts off as the protagonist. And by the way, I'll say one thing about Ethiopia, and I recently discovered that in Washington, D.C., the largest ethnic community or people that migrated to Washington, D.C. from another country is Ethiopians. And this book starts out different than any other Africans in the diaspora, and it's a unique vein that you won't see with Ethiopian writers, where he starts out as a shop owner. And he has other characters in there from other parts in diaspora that are looking up to him. But the mind of the writers from Ethiopian, you won't see pretty much that double consciousness that you would, because remember, Du Bois said it was a result of oppression, enslaved Americans. We found it in oppression, enslaved, and colonized. Ethiopia was never colonized, and we did not discover it in this book. The Beautiful Things That Heaven Bears is... you know, it's one of the best books of New York Times made, but one of the best books of the year. And it's an excellent written book, a great story. I won't give it away, but we did not discover that double consciousness in the writer from Ethiopia. Like I say, all the writers are great writers, but we didn't see it there. And we'll close it out, and hopefully you can click on the tab with a solution to the whole thing. And it was a poem by Derek Walcott, and it's titled Love After Love. And hopefully you can click on the tab to the bottom. And it is a solution to this double consciousness. And I think it's a beautiful, simple poem, but let's let it play out.
Love After Love by Derek Walcott. The time will come when with elation you will greet yourself arriving at your own door, in your own mirror, and each will smile at the other's welcome and say, sit here, eat. You will love again the stranger who was yourself. Give wine, give bread, give back your heart to itself, to the stranger who has loved you all your life, whom you ignored for another, who knows you by heart. Take down the love letters from the bookshelf, the photographs, the desperate notes. Peel your own image from the mirror. Sit. Feast on your life.
I thank you for sitting through the presentation. Apologize for my video slides are not showing up. We'll see how we can clear that up. And remember, you know, you can click and go to the resources with the tab. But I would like to end by saying, you know, we with our unique perspective, we're not trying to change the world. We're just trying to tell the story of a people who we feel are in desperate need of change. Thank you, Asante Santa, and feel free to check out the resources, or for any additional information, feel free to call or email us. Thank you, and hotel.